Hey, what's going on, AP people? We have chapter 26 ready for you today. The Wild West and Farmers. I can't think of anything more exciting, can you? No, I didn't think so. Let's get going. All right, we're going to talk about Frederick Jackson Turner, and he wrote The Significance of the History of the Frontier, or The Frontier Thesis. And here's a quote from it. I'll let you read. If you want to pause it, take a look at it, try to figure out what it's saying. Here's Frederick Jackson Turner, and basically what he is saying here is that he argued that the closing of the frontier had ended an era in American history. So in 1890, and you use the census to figure this out, which has to be taken every 10 years, and that the frontier throughout American history, had promoted democracy. And that's the argument of his writing. Know him? AP loves to ask about Frederick Jackson Turner, especially when they ask about which author is paired with the correct writing. Native Americans, we see during the late 1800s that their population just continues to dwindle due to disease, fighting. The shrinking bison population affected natives. They were hunters, and they tended to hunt the bison or the buffalo population. And due to several things, they had a nomadic lifestyle, so they were hunting the bison. And due to people like Buffalo Bill Cody, who worked for a railroad company and killed over 4,000 buffalo or bison, you'd hear about people riding on a train and just shooting at the buffalo. The buffalo population shrinks drastically, and this negatively affects the Native Americans. Another challenge that they had at the time was the U.S. military natives engaged in several battles during the late 1800s. Two of them, the Battle of Wounded Knee and the Battle of Little Bighorn. Shortly after, in the 1890s, I believe it was, Helen Hunt Jackson wrote a book called A Century of Dishonor, and this is a very important book you will absolutely need to know for the AP exam. So she looks at basically a 100-year time period and chronicles the record of government ruthlessness and deceit towards Native Americans. In other words, here's a list of all the things the government has done wrong towards Native Americans: violation of treaties, kicking them off their land, fighting with them, etc. In 1887, the government passes the Dawes Severity Act, and again, you see stars here, wicked important. I keep saying, you'll hear me say a lot in this chapter that a lot of this stuff is important. I've seen a lot of multiple choice stuff coming from this chapter. What the Dawes Act does is if it changes the identity of Native Americans, it changes their way of life, and it dissolved many tribes as legal entities. In other words, Native Americans were not expected to be members of tribes anymore. It wiped out tribal ownership of land, and instead, it gave up individual Indian family heads with 160 free acres. So the father would get 160 acres, and he and his family were expected to live on this. The impact of this, keep in mind, Native Americans are nomadic, so now they're expected to be farmers. This completely alters the way of natives' lives, and the word you want to associate with the Dawes Act is assimilation, or forcing them to become American. If you assimilate, you are conforming to a group, and they wanted to assimilate Native Americans. And there's a little, I want you to assimilate Uncle Sam, telling them. No Dawes Severity Act, no assimilation. Okay, in 1862, in addition to the Morrill Land Act, which we talked about in Chapter 25, Congress passed the Homestead Act of 1862. And what this does is it encourages settlement of Western land. In other words, it tells people, please move out west. And one way they do that, here's this magic number of 160 acres again. We will give you 160 acres of land. You live on it for 5 years, and you can pay us only $30, the federal government. You do all that stuff, you take care of it for 5 years, this land is yours for a very cheap price. The impact of this act, theory, this sounded great. A lot of people over 5 years could afford the $30. It was free land basically for them. 500,000 Americans took advantage of it. However, land was not always the best. A lot of it was rain scarce and hard to farm. And then railroad companies set up phony names so they can get free land or reduced price land as well. So this encouraged the Western development. Very important to know. The 1890 census, we talked about a little bit with Frederick Jackson's thesis. For the first time in U.S. history, there was no frontier line. You couldn't tell where the frontier line was anymore. And there's this theory called the safety valve theory, which says supposedly during depressions, city unemployed could move west to farm and prosper. So if life was bad, you're going through depression, a panic, you lose your job, there's always this hope or belief that you can move out west. Now, in actuality, few people really did this, but there was this hope, this promise that if things get really bad, we can always move out west. After the 1890 census, that really goes away because there isn't this western land, there's no more room to expand, and more that land is being taken up. And then we see by the 1900s, more and more farmers are moving to the cities. And in 1910, it's the first time that farmers are a minority of the population. Another term to know, and this applies to the South, is a crop lien system. And basically, what this is, a planter or farmer who is poor would have to take out a line of credit or take out a loan at a very, very high interest rate. Problem is, it was nearly impossible for them to pay back, really hard for them to get out of the debt. So this results in a lot of people becoming tenant farmers or sharecroppers, which we talked about in chapter 22 or 23. I can't remember. I apologize. Okay, now we're going to talk about government of the 1890s. We have Benjamin Harrison. His grandfather, remember, William Henry Harrison, Tippecanoe and Tyler II, the election of 1840. Here he is. He has some key accomplishments that you need to know that happened under him. One, the Sherman Antitrust Act, which we talked about in Chapter 25. First time the government ever tries to regulate an industry, and that industry is railroads. The other thing that happens is something called the Sherman Silver Purchase Act, and this is going to have an impact in future elections. This cr increased the supply of silver. So now, instead of using just gold, the federal government would be buying silver as well, and more paper money is in circulation. This was actually a compromise to promote a tariff or to pass a tariff. Westerners, farmers, poor people, people in debt, they love this because it's easier to pay back money. If you're stuck on this, take a look at chapter 24 and I'll summarize the difference between hard and soft money again. Now remember, people who owe money want inflated currency. It's easier to pay back. If you lend somebody money, you don't want inflating currency. You want hard money or gold because then the money is worth more. We're going to have a group of people called the Grange, which are farmers, and basically they got together, they formed cooperatives, and it was a way for them to discuss economic opportunities, social opportunities. But the biggest thing they wanted to do was end monopolies in railroad, and they wanted government ownership of businesses. And this is going to be a prelude to the Populist Party, which we'll talk about in a couple minutes, which will be a prelude to the Progressive Party. We'll talk about in chapter 28 and 29. All right, we've talked about these two key court cases, but they're very important to know again. Munn versus Illinois, the Grange helped influence this. State governments can regulate industries when in the best interest of the public. And this was related to interstate commerce. Then the Supreme Court realizes, about 9 years later, hey, we can't do that. We said it, we established in Gibbons versus Ogden that interstate commerce is only for the federal government, not for the state. So the Wabash case overturns Munn versus Illinois. Third parties, we have the Greenback Labor Party. What do you think they wanted? They wanted greenbacks in circulation, increase the supply of money. Didn't receive many votes, but their ideas were later absorbed. We're going to talk about the Populist Party. Look at this guy, Ignatius Donnelly. Ignatius, that's probably the coolest name I've ever heard. For the Populist Party, he wrote something called the Omaha Platform. Know the Omaha Platform. It's a series of things that they ran on. They wanted free and unlimited coinage of silver at a ratio of 16 to 1, that should say. I don't know where the 16 to 1 went. That means they're going to increase the amount of silver, which will inflate the value of money. A graduated income tax, meaning that the more money you make, the more you should pay in the government. We'll see then the 16th Amendment. Wanted government ownership of the telephone and railroad and telephone and telegraph and railroads. Things initiative, referendum, and recall. We'll get more into these in chapter 28, but basically it gives more political power to people. Postal savings banks, just a safe place to put money run by the government. Limiting government land grants to settlers rather than railroads. So encourage the development of the West to individuals, not companies. And direct election of senators. We will see that in chapter 28 as well with the 17th Amendment. Maybe it's 29. One of those two. And he also wanted an 8-hour workday. But there's Ignatius for you. Okay, a couple strikes you need to know. The Homestead Strike. This was in Andrew Carnegie's Pittsburgh steel plant. People go on strike. State government sided with the owners. Here's the story, guys. Every time there's a strike, with the exception of Teddy Roosevelt, the government, whether it is state or federal government, will side with the owners. Workers will be forced to go back to work. Some of them will get arrested. When in doubt, the government sides with businesses in labor disputes, except when we get to TR, which is chapter. Did you guess it? 28 again. Know that, know that, know that. When in doubt, the government will side with owners. Labor unions, businesses did not like them, so they discourage them any way they can. The Pullman Strike, named after the Pullman cars, railroad cars. We have Eugene V. Debs. He is a person, not a court case. Don't let that V throw you off. Here he is. We will see him in many chapters. He'll be around for about 30 years. He is the leader of this in the federal government, sent in the military. Big surprise is not Teddy Roosevelt, so the federal government is sent in, and they said the strike interfered with U.S. mail, so many of them were arrested. Panic of 1893. You have one guess what causes a panic. What are you going to guess? Over speculation. I hope you got it. We have a stock market crash, overproduction. Basically, this is the exact same thing we'll see with 1929 and the Great Depression. Some results. Well, the government repeals the Sherman Silver Act, so no more buying silver. We also have a gentleman by the name of William Jennings Bryan, and he is very, very famous. We'll see him for multiple chapters as well. He gives a speech called the Cross of Gold speech, and just like my political hero Henry Clay, he ran for president 3 times and lost. And you know what? Even though we're in chapter 26, Henry Clay makes his appearance. You really can't get rid of him. Look at him. Love that guy. And here is his speech, William Jennings Bryan, that is. We will answer their demands for a gold standard by saying to them, "You shall not press down upon the brow of labor with this crown of thorns. You shall not crucify mankind upon a cross of gold." Very famous. He is saying, "Please introduce silver. You are hurting the farmers. You are hurting the people. You are hurting us out west." Legacy of populism. Well, it doesn't last very long, about 25 years. When William Jennings Bryan loses the election of 1896, that's kind of bye-bye populism, but it leads the way for the progressive era, which will be from 1900 to 1920. And some ideas that the progressives carried forward were railroad legislation, graduated income tax, again, that's the 16th Amendment, direct election of senators, that's the 17th Amendment. Senator starts with SE, 17 starts with SE. Ooh, you see what I did there? And also the initiative referendum recall I talked about. I'll give you a quick lowdown on these. Initiative is when individuals can propose laws to the government. Referendum is when individuals can vote on laws, and a recall is when you can get rid of an elected official. Most of that is done on the state level. All right, that's it. If you have not already, please subscribe to my channel. Help spread the word, guys. I love doing these videos. I want to reach as many people as possible. So if you have not already, I beg you, please share this with as many of your friends, people who are taking AP, people who are taking US history, just people who maybe are like me and just love Henry Clay. If you have questions, you want me to explain something, please feel free to leave me, email me, or leave them in the comments. And remember, if you don't spread the word, Henry Clay will get uglier, and he's in rough shape right now, so help him out. All right, that's it. Have a good day, guys.